a lode within the rat's right hind limb. So the rat is of increasing importance for experimental fracture healing studies. And it's well known that the outcome of the fracture healing process strongly depends on biomechanical as well as biological factors. And the most important biomechanical factor is the interfragmentary movement. That means the relative movement of the bone fragments. And of course, this interfragmentary movement depends on the stability of the fixation device. For example, as you can see here on the picture, an external fixator for stabilizing femoral transverse osteotomy. And of course, it depends also on the internal loads inside the femur. So therefore, both parameters need to be known to control the biomechanical factors during healing. So the stability of the fixation device can be easily determined by in vitro tests. However, little is known about the internal loads in the rat's femur during gait. So therefore, the aims of the study were to develop a numerical inverse dynamic model of the rat's right hind limb, and then to determine the internal loads inside the rat's femur during gait. So for development of such a musculoskeletal model, two types of input data must be known. First, an anatomical model containing the bones, the joints, and the muscles needs to be developed. And second, a gait analysis needs to be performed to determine the kinematics of the whole system and, of course, the ground reaction forces. Both types of input data were then used to create a musculoskeletal model inside the antibody modeling system, and this system was then used to solve the undetermined system with an optimization criteria or procedure to calculate the muscle forces, the joint reactions, and of course our desired internal loads inside femur. So about the anatomical model, we used a micro CT scan with a resolution of 160 micrometers, and out of this CT scan, the location of the joints and the bone surface were reconstructed out of this scan. And this scan was done with the rat's lower extremities in a physiological alignment. And furthermore, the mass, the center of mass, and the inertia moments of the pelvis, the femur, the tibia, the metatarsus, and the phalanges with their surrounding soft tissues were determined as well. To determine the course of the muscles in a three-dimensional space, we performed an anatomical study including 15 rats, and this course of muscle was determined by measuring the distance between clear defined anatomical landmarks such as the trochanter major and many points along the muscles. And this data was then implemented inside the antibody modeling system. You could see in the red the dark lines in the model inside the antibody modeling system was implemented as well. So to determine the kinematics during gait, and gait analysis was performed using a constantly driven X-ray transducing rope which was spent inside the lens coverage of two C-arms. The C-arms were placed perpendicular to each other to obtain X-ray images of the rat from the lateral and the dorsal directions. The images were taken at the frequency of 500 Hz, and virtual markers, you can see here the white pixels and the white lines, were then defined on these images on anatomical landmarks. These were, for example, the iliac crest, the joint centers, the centers of the central toe, the patella, and the pivot point of the patella. This X-ray movie was kindly given us from Professor Fischer from the University of Jena, which greatly improved our study, of course. And on this side slide, you could see here a lateral and a view from the rat on that rope, and the top view of this rat, including these white lines, just as a connection between these landmarks we set on these images. And out of these distances between of these landmarks, we calculated time-dependent Euler angles for the joints. For this joint. So the ground reaction forces were not measured directly during gait. They were taken from literature, from the publication of Muir and Wishaw, presented 1999. And this ground reaction force was adjusted to our body weight of about 325 grams. And this force vector, the ground reaction force vector, was applied to the metatarsal from the beginning to the middle of the stance phase, and was then transferred to the phalanges thereafter up to the end of the stance phase, according to Clark and Partner, presented in 1988. Validation is not an easy task about this model. So for validation, the axial strains during gait at the outer femoral diaphysis were estimated based on our calculated internal loads. That means the axial compressive force, Fx, and the bending moment, and the morphogenic properties of the femoral midshaft. These were the cross-sectional area A, the second moment of area I, and the distance A from the center of mass to the anterior lateral surface. These properties were then determined for the diaphyseal femoral cross-section using a CT analysis software. This was CT analysis by Skyscan from Belgium. Using the Euler by Nulli-Beer theory, the resulting maximum normal stress at the anterior lateral surface in the axial direction was calculated based on the axial internal force and the bending moment, and assuming for cortical bone of the rat, a Young's modulus about 25 gigapascal, which was also presented by Keller and Spengler in 1989. These axial strains were, the axial strains were calculated, and these axial strains were then compared to the vivo measurements of Keller and Spengler for this validation. Okay, coming to the results of this validation process, you can see on the left side the vivo data from Keller and Spengler, on the right side our numerical model. On the left side, three gait cycles represented. On the right side, we only have, we only show one gait cycle with a stance phase from 0 to about 0.65 or 0.7, and then the swing phase afterwards. And you could see here qualitatively that it fits quite well. So there is an increase of the axial strength on that surface from the heel strike with the maximum late stance phase, and then a drop off after toe off of this red right height limb. And to have a quantitative view, you could see here that our peak load with about 260 microstrain fits also quite well in the range of the measured in vivo data by Keller and Spengler. Okay, coming to the results of the of our desired internal load in the femur. You can see here that on the top, the internal forces were presented, and on the bottom, the three internal moments were presented. The force was highly dominated by the force in axial direction, with a maximum of up to 6 times body weight, axial compressive force. And the highest bending moment was in the sagittal plane with 11 body weight times millimeter. Okay, coming to the discussion of the whole work. So we could say, or we believe that it was possible to estimate the internal loads during gait. All the data presented and much more data are given in the publication in Journal of Biomechanics. You can see here there. And we could say that it was possible to corroborate the internal loads within vivo data. And afterwards we could say that it was possible to estimate the interfragmentary movement if, with these internal loads, if the three-dimensional stiffness behavior of the fixation device is known. Or otherwise, if you want to adjust, or you could adjust with these internal loads, the stability of the fixation device to an desired interfragmentary movement. And otherwise we could say that with this kind of study, it was possible, or it is possible in the future, to better control the biomechanical factors in experimental fracture healing studies in rats, and therefore to have a closer or a more detailed view on the real biological factors which are influencing the fracture healing process. Last but not least, I want to thank the German Research Foundation and the Professor Friedrich Müller Stiftung.